Andrew Rule, did you say that?
Yes, sir.
So, in the previous class, we were talking about balanced diet. Diet is something, balanced diet is something which we express in terms of food grains. That is maybe cereals, maybe pulses, maybe vegetables, like that. But here, we don't consume pulses, we don't consume cereals. We consume milk, added to it sugar and tea powder, and making it tea or coffee out of it. And then cereals and pulses, whatever they may be, we make into one breakfast item, isn't it? So that is basically the difference between meal and diet. Meal is something which is consumed, whereas diet is something which contributes to the meal or a raw form of meal. So this is a sample meal plan for adult man. So breakfast. Milk should have 100 ml and sugar 15 grams, that is 1 tablespoonful. And then milk serving amount, that is how much milk you should take for tea or coffee, it is half cup. And sugar is 15 grams, that is 1 tablespoonful. So that is how you have to measure and take. Serving is, the servings I will show you what exactly it means. The visuals, they are nothing but tablespoonful, teaspoonful, katora and cup. So cereals, pulses, so all these things, 70 grams of cereals and 20 grams of pulses, make it into idli or dosha or some other thing, but it should contain that much. And then lunch, again it should consist of 120 grams of cereal made into rice, which is 2 cups, and pulkas, 2 numbers, that is wheat. So cereals, both rice and wheat put together, this is what is required for adult man. That is, he is permitted to take 2 pulkas and 2 rice, 2 cups of rice. And similarly pulses, so half a cup of pulse they should take. That is 20 grams. And vegetables, so you can take it any amount of vegetables, 250 grams, 500 grams, no problem. Actually, but what is prescribed is 150 grams of vegetables. So vegetable curry, you make it into it and make it into it, it becomes 3/4 cup. So similarly, tea in the afternoon and then dinner. So now I won't go into the details. But this is sample meal plan for adult man. And similarly, sample meal plan for adult woman. So, what you will take in breakfast? Milk 100 ml, that is half cup, sugar 10 grams, that is 2 cups, that is made into a tea, cereal 50 grams and pulses, much like adult man only. And then lunch is 100 grams. That is 1 cup of rice only she should take. The adult man takes 2 cups of rice and pulkas 2. And then pulses 20 grams, that is half a cup, vegetables 100 grams or 125 grams, 150 grams. And then milk again in the tea hour, tea time, and pulses again in the night 20 grams, vegetables 100 grams, milk. And then vegetables 50 grams, fruit and all those things. And some amount of vegetables have to be consumed in the form of salad also, because the salads give you antioxidants. So note, for non-vegetarians, substitute one pulse portion, that is why it is pulse portion cup, with the, so pulse portion is half a cup, that is 30 grams. And so for non-vegetarian, substitute one pulse portion with one portion of egg, meat or chicken or fish. Use 20 grams visible fat and less than 5 grams salt during preparation of meal per day. 5 grams is, you are entitled to take 1 teaspoonful, that's all, salt throughout the day. And 20 grams of visible fat, that is maybe oils or in a, so what kind of oils and all those things I will be talking in the subsequently. So breakfast items, so usually idlis 3 numbers, dosa 2 numbers, upma 1 cup, bread 3 slices, porridge is 1.5 cups, and corn flakes with milk 1.5 cups, not more than that. Snacks, poha 1 cup, toast 2 slices, and dokla 4 numbers. For non-vegetarian, substitute one pulse portion with the one portion of, this is already there, repetition. So now this is what is a meal. Now I have spoken about balanced diet and I have spoken about meal also. I have not spoken anything about nutrients, that is vitamins, proteins, carbohydrates, because their detailed metabolism and end products of the metabolism and their utilities, their uses and all those things, they have been effectively covered to you in biochemistry. That's why I have left them out, because there is no point in repeating what you already know. So dietary guidelines. Now this is balanced diet, but these are the, those are the balanced diet is just a definition, a kind of a definition, which allows for some amount of extra calories for, and extra protein for a lean period also. So now this is dietary guidelines, sir. This is altogether different. How you should formulate your diet at all? What are the guidelines? So eat variety of foods and consume balanced diet. So your diet should not be a monotonous, monochromatous diet. That is rice and one curry. It should not be like that. So your diet preferably should consist of tuber, like a carrot, green leafy vegetables, and then cucumber or onion and all those things as salad, and then some amount of oil, and then reasonable amount of milk. And if you are a non-vegetarian, then one egg. So all these things, you have to consume all the variety of foods. You should never confine yourself to a monochromatous and monotonous food. Second, ensure extra calories, proteins and micronutrients during pregnancy and life. This is the most important thing. Pregnant woman, there is a baby in her tummy, and so she is reluctant to eat. Even if she eats also, she can't eat much. In fact, it is precisely during this period that she requires extra nutrients. So that's obviously in the form of diet. So iron and folic acid tablets and the vitamin C and all those things which we give as supplements, we prescribe as per supplements, they are only secondary. The basic thing is they should consume from the diet. Otherwise, this may or may not help. They ensure extra calories, proteins and micronutrients during pregnancy and lactation, especially calcium also. Calcium, iron, folic acid, and then cyanocobalamin. These are the things which should be made available compulsorily for every pregnant lady and lactating woman. Apart from that, calcium also. Calcium also should be taken care of, because extra calcium. So exclusive breastfeeding for 6 months and encourage breastfeeding till child is of 2 years of age. This is what is most important. Say, when you are, every child should be put to breast This is invariably it has to be done. You have to educate the people. So within half an hour, preferably within half an hour, when the mother is ready, her clothes are changed after delivery and all that. So then immediately, within half an hour, the child should be put to rest. Maximum allowable period is 1 hour, not more than that. Child should not be given any kind of sources of energy such as glucose, water and all those things. They are in fact harmful to the newborn. So the best nutrition for the newborn, best source of energy for the newborn is mother's milk itself. So that is the reason why we emphasize that child should be put to breast within 1 hour of birth. And then the breastfeeding should continue at least for 6 months. Exclusive breastfeeding. That during that period, other foods are not given. Especially, but many mothers will not be, their lactational performance, their ability to produce enough milk is somewhat limited. So naturally, they may require, some children may require artificial, artificial, but extra milk, such as cow milk. The best substitute to mother's milk is again cow's milk, which is nearest to mother's milk in composition. So encourage breastfeeding till child is of 2 years of age and feed home-based semi-solids after 6 months. This is what we call as weaning. This weaning is a must because breast milk and these things. Second thing is cow milk and things like that. They will not be able to support the child. Moreover, if you don't introduce weaning foods, that is supplements, then there are chances of the child developing a kind of a diarrhea called as weaning diarrhea. That is, so this solid foods which we suggest are required for the colonization of the gut by helpful commensal bacteria. That's the reason why we advocate very strongly from 6 months onwards semi-solid foods after 6 months. And adequate and appropriate diet for children and adolescents. This is another area where we have to take a lot of precautions. Say, because especially with a girl child, she should have food rich in iron, that is green leafy vegetables, or probably if they can afford some amount of chicken and mutton like that. Because chicken and mutton, they constitute a ready-made source of iron, that is heme. The bioavailability of iron from chicken, mutton and fish is very high when compared to bioavailability of iron from non-vegetable foods. Then eat plenty of vegetables and fruits. This plenty of vegetables and fruits are required, especially as far as possible. We should eat the vegetables in raw form. That is, wash the vegetables thoroughly and then make it into a salad, because that is a rich source of antioxidants. And prime them with a little bit of olive oil. If you are interested, you can put some pieces of kismis or something like that, some dates, so that it becomes sweet. And then you can make it into a tasty salad and then eat it. So that is the best way of consuming vegetables. But the next best way definitely is cooking, boiling and cooking thoroughly. And moderate use of oils and ghee, butter and vanaspati should be sparingly used. Vanaspati should be avoided. Vanaspati means dalda. And ghee and butter should be used very sparingly. That is 5 ml, a spoon of food. Not more than that. And even oils also. Polyunsaturated fatty acids, some monounsaturated fatty acids, oils which are rich in, only they should be used. If necessary, some saturated fat in the form of ghee and butter can be taken, but it should constitute only 10% of your fat intake, energy intake, and avoid overeating. This is my regular and routine advice to any patient. Say, just let your stomach be a little bit empty. You will come to know when you are approaching the point of satiety. So just eat one bowl of food less, or one idli less, or half a idli less. So never eat tummy full. So regular exercise and be physically active. Again, about physical activity, I have got a very important slide to display. I have due course of time. At appropriate place in the lecture, I will be talking about. So use salt in moderation and restrict excessive salt. Especially cut down all the pickles. Pickles are the source of excessive salt. And then even in the vegetable curries which we prepare, it is better to use small amount of salt, especially. A permissible intake of salt per person per day is 5 grams, and above that, it is not advised. So, dietary guidelines 3. So, right cooking methods and healthy eating habits. This is very important. Healthy eating habits are very, very important. That is, healthy eating habit, have a breakfast like a king, that is belly full. And then lunch like a queen, very limited, and then dinner like a beggar, that is very, very limited and small amounts of food, dinner. That is the right healthy eating habit. And don't go to sleep, don't become inactive as soon as you eat. Eat at least 1 hour or 2 hours prior to, and eat inside only, that is in your home only. Don't go outside and eat at the outside eateries, because the heating or the cooking process, a healthful cooking practice also, and that cooking practice will be under your control if you eat in your house. It will not be under your control if you go to a restaurant or a hotel or something like that. So drink plenty of water and beverages in moderation. This is very, very important. Again, that is plenty of water is 3.5 liters of water in the case of adults. That is, it works out to some 9 to 10 glasses of water. If you drink in excess also, it doesn't matter. Don't worry that it will be overload on kidneys. It will never be an overload. So this is very important. Drinking plenty of water has got dual benefit. That is, keeps you always hydrated, reasonably well hydrated, and the second thing is that it prevents constipation also. So minimize use of processed foods which have more fat, salts and sugars, kulkulis, cakes, all such processed foods. Biscuits, chocolates, and all these things, just an occasional helping of it, that's fine, but it should not be a routine. And elderly people should use diets rich in micronutrients, and calorie intake should be in moderation. Sedentary adult, he should not consume like whatever is prescribed in balanced diet. That level of eating should not be there. Because their basal metabolic rate comes down, so naturally they have to decrease their energy consumption also. So exclusive breeding, breastfeeding for 6 months. Breast milk is the most natural and perfect food for normal growth. and healthy development of infants. So, what are the benefits of breast milk? Colostrum is rich in nutrients and anti-infective factors and should be fed to the infants. Invariably, there is a wrong practice. Of course, now that practice is slowly becoming obsolete, but this colostrum is rich in IgG and IgM antibodies, which are responsible for local immunity in the infant. And the second thing is, it has got so many maternal antibodies. Third is, it is rich in cerebrospinals and sphingomyelins, which are so necessary for development of infant's central nervous system. So this is a very, very valuable source of nutrients, and don't deprive the newborn infant of colostrum. And breastfeeding reduces risk of infections, because always maternal antibody will be, some amount of maternal antibody will be getting transferred. And as I have told you, the breast milk also, not only colostrum, but breast milk. The colostrum is nothing but a very concentrated form of breast milk itself. So it establishes mother-infant contact and promotes mother-child bonding. Especially, it contributes to the psychological well-being of the infant. Breastfeeding reduces risk of infections. It prolongs birth interval by fertility control. There is something such as a lactational amenorrhea, you may be knowing, or in physiology you would have already been taught. If not taught, in due course of time they will teach you. That lactational amenorrhea has got a partial contraceptive effect. Don't depend upon lactational amenorrhea as a contraception source of that later on. Now right now I don't want to go into it. But to some extent, breastfeeding can help in fertility control, just to this extent you remember. And breastfeeding helps in retraction of the uterus. That also is there, definitely. See, what is this retraction of the uterus? I would like to elaborate a little. Usually, the uterus is a pelvic organ and almost of the size of a fist, not more than that. But during pregnancy, it becomes an abdominal organ, and it ascends up to almost all the zygister, and even in the sides also bulges. So there is an enormous increase in the area of the uterine, endometrium, myometrium, and all those things. So after delivery, after childbirth, the uterus retracts again back into the pelvis. So that is called as involution of uterus. And so breastfeeding promotes this involution of uterus. That is the most important, another important benefit for the mother. And the incidence of breast cancer is lower in mothers who breastfeed their children. This is a statistical association. Breastfeeding is associated with better cognitive development of children and may provide some long-term health benefits. I said, first of all, it gives a sense of security to the child. And then, as I have told, cerebrospinals and sphingomyelins, which are necessary for myelination of the nervous system, infant's young nervous system, that takes place naturally, the child acquires better cognitive abilities. The exclusivity of breast milk, rich in lactagum, that is, which is easily digestible, and lactoferrin, it also has got lactoferrin also, which is a source of iron. Usually milk will not get, the cow milk and these sources will not have iron. So it has got a reasonable amount of lactoferrin and docosahexaenoic acid. And then this is one kind of a fatty acid which will promote local immunity. And contains macrophages, anti-infective antibodies, IgA globulins, lysozymes, and several other enzymes, which can ensure some amount of local immunity, and protects against hypocalcemia, hypomagnesemia, These are the things which infant is likely to develop. But mother is having enough food. If mother, remember one thing, this infant is a very, 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 very fastidious parasite. He sucks the nutrients mercilessly from the mother. If mother is having some amount of calcium, first of all he will take it and then leaves the mother, say, anemic or calcium, hypocalcemia. Usually hypocalcemia in Indian circumstances it wouldn't occur because we are basically rice eaters and rice supplies reasonable amount of calcium. So the breastfed babies have 8 extra IQ points. Indian women secrete 750 ml in first 6 months and 400 ml during the next 6 months. That is 750 ml per day. This is only hypothetical. This is a figure, maximum amount which can be secreted by an Indian woman. Average, their performance works out to some 300 to 400 ml. So infant requirement of breast milk is 150 ml per kg of the body weight. So, usually Indian average Indian weight of Indian is so 6. So, he by the time he is 5 years old, he doubles his weight. That is, he will become 5 kg or 6 kg. So, how much the at 6 kg level, 900 ml. But mother will be able to supply maximum 750 ml. So that 150 ml nutrition gap will be there. That is the reason why we advocate introduction of semi-solid foods. Introducing supplementary foods around 6 months. Advisable to introduce cow milk at the end of second month along with breast milk. That's what I have been telling. Because most of the Indian mothers, their lactational performance is not up to the mark. So that is the reason why we should introduce supplementation. And the rooting reflex, trunk protrusion reflex, gag reflex, all these things develop by all these things are required for either in the artificial feeding or for breastfeeding. So this development itself is dependent upon, again, proper myelination. So 6th month introduction of semi-solid food. By 4th to 6th month, infant's gag reflex develops, enabling him to swallow semi-solid food. That is the reason why we say introduce semi-solid foods only after 6th month. Otherwise, what will happen? Infant's gag reflex will not be there for an infant who is below the age of 4 months. So naturally, he is likely to choke. And choking is a very big cause of infant death, sir, actually. So that's the reason why we should not introduce semi-solid foods too early. So the range is 4 to 6 months, but to be on the safe side, better to introduce on 5th or 6th month. Hence, initially it is necessary to introduce semi-solid food only by 6th month in small quantities and increasing it gradually. So, what can be given in Indian setting? So, NIN has given a very clear specifications regarding amount of, for instance, khichdi. So, amount of rice, amount of green gram dal, and amount of leafy vegetables and fat. They have given clear things, but you should remember that they are always, they are supplementary foods, they are not substitute to breast milk. And some few things you can remember if you want to. So, khichdi, and then malted ragi porridge, and then wheat payasam, kheer, all these things, they are accepted well by the infant and they give reasonable amount of supplementation, which is very, very, very essential once the child becomes say 6 months old. 6 months old, yes. So at that time, he requires 900 ml of milk. Mother at best will be able to give 750 ml. So there is a gap. So adequate and appropriate diet for children 6 to 11 years and adolescents 11 to 18 years. Take extra care because this is childhood and adolescence are the stages of growth, both physical growth as well as intellectual growth. Because from 6th year onwards, we go to school, children go to school, and they develop so many intellectual faculties which are required for in future for them. And similarly, physical growth also. The boys and girls, they mature physically, they mature sexually, and they gain in height as well as weight. So all these things require appropriate amounts of protein, calorie, fats, micronutrients, especially micronutrients. In girl child, most of the girl children, they do suffer from anemia, and that should not happen. So they should be given diet rich in iron and folic acid. So take extra care in feeding a young child and include soft cooked vegetables and seasonal fruits. Give plenty of milk and milk products to children and adolescents. Promote physical activity and appropriate lifestyle practices. Discourage overeating as well as indiscriminate dieting. And this is another end of the spectrum, is that say in the rural areas, even in the urban slums, say the people are deprived of enough food, appropriate food. Whereas in the affluent sections, they are also consuming inappropriate foods like overeating, or sometimes for the purpose of looking slim and all those things, they are doing indiscriminate dieting also. Both should be avoided. And a nutritionally adequate diet is essential for optimal growth and development. And appropriate diet and physical activity during childhood is essential for optimum body composition, BMI, body mass index, and to reduce the risk of diet-related chronic diseases in later life and prevent vitamin deficiency. All these things, diet-related common chronic diseases, all these things are diet-related. Diabetes, hypertension, ischemic heart disease. All these things are, so especially one should not consume food rich in trans fats. I will speak to you about trans fats in the next, after few slides. And common infections and malnutrition contribute significantly to child morbidity and mortality. A child needs to eat more during and after episodes of infections to maintain. See, in our country there is a bad habit that when the child is having fever or having diarrhea, they say that you discontinue food. Lankhanam paramas. No, this is not the right approach. In fact, it is during that period, even during the intra-infection period and post-infection period also, he or she should take appropriate diet. Whatever food they can take, they should be allowed and encouraged. So eat green leafy vegetables in plenty and seasonal fruits. Include green leafy vegetables in daily diet. It should be part of your diet. Eat as much of other vegetables as possible daily. And then eat vegetables, fruits in all your meals. See, one thing very, very usefulness of these vegetables is that they add roughage to your diet. And they add taste to your diet. And they are very rich in B complex group of vitamins. And if consumed as salads, they will give enough of antioxidants which are necessary to fight infections. So consume raw and fresh vegetables as salads. Grow the family's requirements of vegetables in the kitchen garden if possible. This is one thing which is very very dear to me. In fact, the home-grown vegetables, that is very, very important. And green leafy vegetables, when properly cleaned and cooked, are safe even for infants. Let different varieties of vegetables and fruits add color to your plate and vitality to your life. And beta-carotene rich foods like dark green, yellow and orange colored vegetables and fruits, that is green leafy vegetables, carrots, papayas and mangoes, protect from vitamin A deficiency. This is another important topic which is required. In fact, this is discrete use. As you know, 30% of 20 to 30% of our energy requirement should come from fat. But what kind of fat? That is the most important thing. So what kind of fat it should be? So the golden rule is 10% of the calorie requirements only should come from saturated fat. Saturated fat is fat, animal fats, maybe milk, maybe ghee, maybe butter, or the invisible fat which you consume along with an egg or with chicken and things like that. So only 10% only should come from saturated fat, yes. Which are the saturated fatty acids, lauric acid, myristic acid, oleic acid, all these, so many other acids, the stearic acid. So all these things, they are called as saturated fatty acids. So saturated fats consist of saturated fatty acids, and their contribution should be only 10% of our energy requirements. This point I am emphasizing repeatedly. Now once again here, we are showing that. What are saturated fatty acids? Coconut oil, palm kernel oil, ghee, butter and vanaspati. And then monounsaturated, what are they? Red palm oil, palm oil oil, groundnut oil, rice bran oil and sesame. So remaining 20% of body's energy requirements, which fats are giving, they should come from a judicious admixture of monounsaturated fatty acids and polyunsaturated fatty acids. That is red palm oil, palm oil oil or groundnut oil or rice bran oil or sesame oil, nuvul and nune. So these things on one side, and then polyunsaturated fatty acids. There are certain oils which are rich in polyunsaturated fatty acids. That is again safflower oil, sunflower oil, cotton weed oil, soybean oil and corn oil. At least in South India they are not available. Cotton seed oil, corn oil and soybean, safflower oil, kusumanune, that is available, and sunflower oil, that is very available in plant. And net even groundnut oil, rice bran oil, they consist of moderate quantities. And red palm oil and palm oil oil, they are not, usually I don't advise them, because they supply only monounsaturated fatty acids. See, the merit of monounsaturated fatty acids is that it has got only one unsaturation bond, so they won't get polymerized very soon. That is, they can withstand heating in the pan for quite some time, whereas these oils are somewhat fair. So that is why I always advocate a good and a judicious admixture of, in this, the best thing is groundnut oil and the second best is rice bran oil in monounsaturated. And in polyunsaturated fatty acid oils, sunflower oil and safflower oil. So you should mix them judiciously and consume. So here I have given the different combinations also. Groundnut oil or sesame oil or rice bran oil plus mustard oil. Groundnut oil plus sesame oil or rice bran oil plus canola oil. Like this. So monounsaturated and polyunsaturated fatty acids, both are consumed in adequate quantities. So this is another very, very important point. Exercise regularly and increase physical activity. This is for more. And exercise basically is of three types. That is, one is aerobic exercises, that is which exercise your heart, that is which increases your heart rate and takes it to a particular target heart rate, that depends on your target heart rate. So this is called as aerobic exercises, walking, brisk walking, running, jogging, dancing, all these activities, swimming, all these activities, they increase your heart rate. And in the process, when the heart is beating faster and faster and more powerfully, to cope up with the increase of oxygen demand, what happens exactly is that your heart also gets extra. Yes? Evandi? So that is aerobic activity. And calisthenic activity is the muscle strengthening activity. And finally, the third type of activity is stretching, muscle stretching exercises or tendon exercises. So physical activity is essential to maintain ideal body weight by burning excess calories and is of vital significance to health and prevention of non-communicable diseases. Physical activity is a major modifiable risk factor in reduction of non-communicable and chronic diseases. Physical activity may reduce the risk of falls and injuries in the elderly, and exercise is a prescriptive medicine. Always remember, do some exercise. It is not like that. What exercise has to be done, how much of exercise has to be done, and for what duration a person should involve in exercise. This is a prescriptive medicine. It is not a substitute for physical activity. Move your body as much as you can. That is what I say. When I say it is physical activity. So physical activity pyramid. See, you can see. Basically, say level 1 lifestyle activities. And then at level 2, active aerobics. That is level 3, flexibility exercises, and level 4, rest and inactivity. This should be the least and this should be the most. Lifestyle activities is doing so, not exactly taking dog to for a walk. That is just an appealing kind of lifestyle activities. In fact, so many household chores, all of them doing by yourself. This makes very good physical activity. And it should constitute the maximum, it should contribute to the, it should contribute, it should make a maximum contribution to your activity. Next is aerobic. And the third is, so like this. So energy balance, this is, I think you are familiar with this. So energy input, maintenance of body weight and body composition, and that is energy input is useful, and then energy output, that is energy balance. So this is a long list of physical activities. What I mean, sleeping, resting, say they consume 1 kilocalorie per minute, suppose. Yes, anatomy solids, right? Okay. Now it's already 10:30. So I will continue in the next class. Sorry, sir.
Yeah.